Well, welcome all. So, gosh, I am really honored that we have this incredible guest, DeRay McKesson, with us today. You have longer bios. You probably don't need too much of an introduction, but I'll say a few words by way of introduction, and welcome to those of you who are just joining us to the HNLR Symposium on ADR and Activism. So DeRay is an organizer, he's an activist, he's an educator, he's one of the leaders of the Black Lives Matter movement, and really one of the leading voices in our country in the effort to confront the killings of black and minority populations. He's a co-founder of Protester Newsletter and Campaign Zero. Campaign Zero is a grassroots effort that tries to marry data and community organizing to end police violence. In 2015, Fortune magazine named him as one of the 50 greatest leaders in the world. He has appeared on The Late Show with Stephen Colbert. He actually, in July of 2016, had a four-hour meeting at the White House with President Obama. Somehow, the incredibly persuasive powers of the Harvard Negotiation Law Review persuaded him to spend an afternoon with us. We know this is kind of a far cry from Colbert or Obama, but we are really excited and honored to have you. Please join me in welcoming DeRay McKesson.
Good to be here.
So I thought we might start. You know, you are educator, organizer, activist, and you know the symposium is trying to get those of us in the ADR and dispute management, dispute resolution world to think about some of the ways that we can make a difference in this growing need in our country around activism, and also manage some of the kind of tensions that sometimes come up for us in that space where we're trying to bring people together across really, really big differences. And so I wanted to ask you what your thoughts are, what advice you could give to us from your experience on how we should think about bringing together populations where there are often really huge systemic and structural power and differences into a room. What are the kinds of things that we ought to be thinking about? What concerns do you have about that? Do you even think it's a good idea? And if so, what should kind of be in our mind?
So it's good to be here. I appreciate everybody coming to this talk and excited for any questions at the end. I'll say, you know, I've been struggling, especially in this context of the Trump presidency. It's been a long 29 days for all of us. And I haven't written much about it yet because part of it is this question of, like, who do we work with in this moment? Is that there were so many people on the left who did a couple things. There were people who we love and respect who said that voting for Hillary would be, like, morally wrong. There were people who said that we could afford to lose an election. And there were people who I think were seduced by this notion of a productive apocalypse, this idea that, like, he will become president and it'll force us to confront, like, all of these issues and ills that we've never confronted before, and that in the confrontation we'll finally deal with the truth of America. And what we know to be true is that the only thing that happens in a productive apocalypse is the apocalypse, right? Mm-hmm. And that, like, when the system comes to a grinding halt, that it actually never grinds to a halt, but it does grind certain people down to ashes. And that's what we've seen. And I say that because, not necessarily to blame people on the left, but to call into question people who are willing to sacrifice the lives of real people for this ideological commitment to whatever, or their sense of ideological purity. And I worry about that. So I've been thinking a lot as an organizer, like, what does it mean to move forward with people who, like, have not yet reflected on sort of their willingness to fight for ideological purity in the absence of, like, real choices. Like, we make decisions every day about real things and, like, real people's lives. So that's, like, one whole set of it. There are also people who ask, like, would I ever meet with Trump, right? And I would say that somebody should meet with him, right? Like, somebody should tell him, like, what is right and what is wrong. But I don't know if that is, like, my place in the work. I think that, you know, he's only, like, used people in some ways. And there is something about, like, having a seat at the table is, like, an important thing. I think about the meeting with Obama, which was a long 4 hours, and I love President Obama. 3 hours in, it's like, are there cookies? Is there water? You're like, what is going on? This is long. And it was right after I got arrested in Baton Rouge, so I was like annoyed with the government. You know, it was like Attorney General Loretta Lynch was two seats down. The FBI had just visited my house, and when the FBI visits, they leave like a business card that says, it was like, DeRay, please call me. And you're like, I'm not calling the FBI. And I see Lynch, and I'm like, hey, Lynch, the FBI visited my house. And she like expertly looked like I just didn't even say anything. She was like, good to see you. And I was like, but so I believe in having a seat at the table. I think that, you know, when you have a seat at the table, it's about making sure the truth is present. And like, we always knew that we weren't the only people who could bring the truth, right? Yeah. Like, a seat at the table was also about making sure we kept the door open for new people. With Trump, I don't know what a seat at the table looks like. I am interested in like, how do we bring communities together, right? Especially in the sort of in the spirit of resistance in these moments. I'm mindful of two things, and I'll finish answering to this question, I promise. Two things. One is that this is fundamentally about ideas in so many ways. So like, I've been fascinated with this thing in my mind that I call, or my head, when ideas become weapons, that I think what the right has done so well is like use these ideas and weaponize them. I think that what the left has done is that we believe that like the best idea wins. And what we know to be true is that the best idea doesn't always win, that the idea that gets beat into people's head over and over and over, like that is the idea that wins. Mm-hmm. And I'm mindful that the government rarely changes people's minds. It often changes people's behaviors, but like neighbors change people's minds. Mm-hmm. So how do we like equip people to like have these tough conversations? And the second part of that is like the having the tough conversation is that we have to be mindful to like share the cognitive work. That what I've seen people do, especially around race, is that people who like get it, they'll talk to somebody who they want to get it, and they do all of the work. So it's like, you know, people will say like Mike Brown, you know, did X, Y, and Z that pretty much is them saying Mike Brown deserved to die. And what I could do is be like, well, Mike didn't do this and da-da-da-da-da. But now what I do is say like, well, tell me why do you think Mike Brown should be dead, right? Like you, I'm putting the cognitive work back on you, or people will be like, DeRay, should the police kill people? And I'm like, should the police kill your child? And they're like, I don't know. I'm like, well, I don't know either, right? Like let's put the work, the cognitive work back on you, that like what I can do is like ask the question and like help you think about it in a non-judgmental way. But I think sometimes what we do is we take the burden on fully.
Yeah. So there's a lot of questions I want to ask coming from that. And I'm not, gosh, where to start? I'm going to maybe try to do it sequentially. So I want to ask, you know, you talked about the left and during the election, right? I can't vote for Hillary because she represents the system, you know, and the system is inherently dysfunctional, not working, flawed, versus, you know, a practicality, like, well, what are your other choices?
And like, when did a billionaire become a man of the people? Like, that is just...
Yeah. Okay, yeah. So that's right. So that's another question, right? But what about all these people who say, you know, I'm not voting for him. I'm just not voting. You know, one of the things we talk about in our field is, and I hear you kind of embedded in this, is there's something about the individual conflict intervention, right? Saving lives, transforming the way these set of five people see each other. That's really powerful. But then there's a critique sometimes that you're not looking enough at the systemic question. I wonder how you think about, because my sense, right, is the Bernie Sanders people were saying, we're gonna change the system. She's gonna, you know, tinker around a few people. How do you think about that in the work that you have done as an activist and as an educator?
Yeah, I think what this election did is it shattered a lot of myths. One was, I was just with Attorney General Holder and Sally Yates. Sally Yates is amazing.
Yes, yeah.
She was great. And somebody in the room we were in, we did this like public talk, but before that we had this smaller talk, and somebody said, you know, we have to remember that all politics is local. And I think that that like sounds beautiful, I get it, and I think the spirit of it is like true in the spiritual sense. But what this was a reminder of is that politics is also national, right? That like it wasn't the local government that stopped people from coming into the country, right? It's not the local government that's gonna mobilize the National Guard or like the army. Like that the federal government actually has a real impact on people's lives every single day. We just didn't realize it when it was working smoothly, but we have all felt these 29 days individually, like as individual 29 days. And I think that what is probably true is that people organize locally. That like people organize with people they know in their homes, in their neighborhoods, in their schools. But like politics has like a much broader reach. And I think that there were people who said, I'm not going to vote for the president because it doesn't matter. I'm going to vote for my like city councilman. I'm going to vote for my mayor and my state legislator. And I think that we're now seeing the consequence of that. That if you look at the Heritage Foundation's budget that they're proposing, it's like not only the end of Obamacare, which is making the most news, but like the end of Head Start, for instance, which would do so much damage to low-income neighborhoods, or like the end of welfare. Like, these are like real things that local organize, like there's no local fix for. Like most urban places can't account for the end of Head Start. Like there's no mechanism, there's no money to do that. And I think that the rhetoric will change, I think, hereafter, when people talk about like what does the presidency do in terms of real people's lives. And I think that that is important.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. So let me ask you that another thing that you said. You said, I don't know, but I want to push you on it. You said, I don't know if I'd meet with Trump. I don't know if that's my role. I'm curious, there's clear reasons why you would not, particularly if it were public or there was a chance of it being tweeted or otherwise being public, right? I'm curious if you got an invitation and a guarantee that it would remain private, it wouldn't be tweeted, and it was a chance to have a half an hour with him. How did you think about that?
Yeah, I would be way less inclined to do that. Like, I would probably only meet with him if it was, like, live streamed.
Okay, all right, say more about that.
You know, like, if it was, like, the most public form. Yeah, because we've gotten no indication that he's, like, somebody to be trusted. Right?
Yeah, uh-huh,
so, like,
uh-huh.
He would agree to it not being public 1 minute, and then it'd be on the news being, like, DeRay is an awful person who said, you know, like, would happen. So I think that, like, something that was streamed and as public as possible would probably be the only way.
Got it. Okay. And that's mostly because you wouldn't trust his work. Yeah,
no,
I get that.
Want him to be able to, because I get that the president has, like, a bully pulpit on, like, you know, he is the only news right now. Like, Beyonce is probably the only person who has broken through the Trump cycle in the past 29 days because she was robbed of the Grammy.
Yeah.
So, he is a huge bully pulpit, and it's not lost on me that if we allow that White House to control the narrative, that people will always be fighting an uphill battle. So that's why I think that all the conversations you have on race are just really unproductive, is that you get Steve Harvey, you get Kanye, who do have big platforms, but they just don't have the power to withstand the messaging machine that, like, the White House just has as an apparatus. So we see Kanye delete the tweets. I'm like, yeah, that's fine, but like, you did real damage when you met with him and validated him, and he gave you that the thing that was like, my friend Kanye. You're like, that is, they're using you, you know?
Yeah. So let me ask, still going back to your initial answer, you talked about the importance of conversations on the ground between real people and communities. I'm curious how you, what are the ones that you've seen work? What does work mean? And, you know, how could we replicate those things? So what are the kind of pitfalls that we should be thinking about in terms of how we set up the space, who gets invited, and then how do we kind of follow through on that? Because I think many people in this room, that's the kind of work that elite are thinking about, that they want to be involved in, and they want to make sure that that work gives voice and empowers and doesn't end in the room or actually replicate power or voice or agency imbalances. So I'm curious to hear your thoughts and experience on that.
Yeah, I would say two things. One is that so much of this, I do believe, is like about the idea and the message, like who wins the messaging more. I think that the right is just much better at boiling really complex things down to really simple terms. Like death panels, really simple, people get it, it's still alive, but like it travels far, moves. And the left's response is like, that's not true, but if you look at page 700,000 of the ACA, and you're like, that's just not a good talking point.
Yeah.
Right? Like, not helpful, it doesn't work. So I think that there has to be a clear strategy to like arm people with language that people can like repeat in living rooms. I think that what we did sort of by happenstance really well in the protest was like we gave people that language. So I think about the protests in like Baltimore and Ferguson where there's property damage, and we would say to people, like, if you disagree with this, then you disagree with the Boston Tea Party and the American Revolution, right? And then they'd be like, well, that's not what I meant. And you're like, well, what did you mean, right? Or like, I don't have to condone it to understand it, right? Like, or broken windows, broken spines, or like things that we tried to be intentional about giving people language that like aunts and uncles could repeat.
So you're saying that you wanna, that part of this is giving in a conversation where we might have people who have very different views that the response to, you know, broken windows, right, is broken spines in that dialogue.
Yeah, I think that, so in this moment, I don't do much with immigration work right now just because I feel like I've done so much about the police. I'm like policed out like everybody else should be because the police need some real work. But I think about the phrase, there's this, I saw this slogan somewhere like no person is illegal, and I love it. I think that's like a beautiful, it's simple, easily repeatable, like already does a lot of work. You don't have to like do a lot of explanation. Like it's a powerful phrase. And I think that we just have not been as thoughtful about seeding these things so that they spread and like they do work on their own. I think love is love is a great example of something that like did a lot of work, or like the equal sign from the HRC, like did a lot of work on its own that like people, it didn't take a lot of cognitive energy to move. And I think in this moment, that's like why I would say one of the pitfalls of the left is that like we just haven't, we're, because we know we're right with regard to equity and justice, we just assume that being right means that we will win, as opposed to putting in the work to like see that. The second thing, I was on the MARC train, and so I live in Baltimore, and I was coming from some event in DC, and I was on the MARC train, and I was sitting behind, it was three white people sitting in like a sort of two-sectioned Ford thing, and it was this guy who was like a low-key Trump supporter. Like he wouldn't say he was a Trump supporter, but like everything he said was very, I support Trump. And he was sitting across from these two white, it was like a white woman across from him, and then they were friends like sitting sort of next to her. And she was going toe-to-toe with him, and it was amazing. I was like tweeting the whole time, like, this white woman is on it. And what was so great about her is that it was this like sort of, she was like informed and tough in a way that was also compassionate, right? Mm-hmm. So she wasn't judgmental towards him, but everything he would say, she'd be like, but why did you do this? Like, what did you mean by that? Do you not think that? And it was so great because she was, the cognitive weight was being pushed on him. Like, she wasn't having to do it, but she was informed enough to like make him have to show up cognitively. And like, that was important. And I think that this is really a time where white people have to step up, right? That like, people are gonna say things around white people that they would never say around me, which is probably a good thing for both of us. But it does mean that like, we need white people who can like navigate those conversations and are willing to do it. I think about protests as this idea of telling the truth in public. And so, and I'm also mindful that like we aren't born woke, something wakes us up. And for so many people, it was a tweet or a Facebook post or like a random dinner at a random dinner somewhere, like a random conversation that like made people think differently. Mm-hmm. And one of the things I worry about with the protest now is that, you know, I was with Holder, and Holder said, we were at the thing, and Holder was like, you know, the protest was such a beautiful explanation of, and I was like, Eric, you did not say that 2 years ago, right? Where was this like amazing defense of protest as like the most American thing that could happen? Which is interesting. But one of the things now that protest is like so sort of mainstream is that people, I think, have mistakenly started to think about protest as the answer, right? We were always really clear that protest created space for the answer, that protest was always about forcing public conversations about things that people were trying to ignore. We never believed that protest was the thing that was gonna change the world. And I think that we have to start like using the protest space to open up space for conversation, but push people for material wins. Great.
So how do we do that? Because this is what's interesting, thinking about in our mediation space. So much of our work often is in some ways the opposite of what you said. That is to say, we don't want to take a one-liner that lands, but we want to complexify, find nuance, dig in. And yet part of what you are saying, which does resonate with me from an activist side, is we need powerful one-line slogans that get people alive, or get people woke to what's happening, that then creates a space. But then I guess my question then is, how is it, like, it's kind of paradoxical that a bunch of competing slogans create a space to have a nuanced conversation or a conversation that can get more granular. So what are your thoughts? How do we do that? Or what am I missing?
Yeah, I think I'm saying two things. Yeah. One is, and I don't think about them as slogans. I think about them as like simple truths, right?
Yeah, truth.
Like people, the police shouldn't kill people, I think is like a true statement, right? So I don't think about those as slogans. Yeah. So I think that we should, I think we need to figure out how do we distill complex things into like simple statements for people, because the reality is that people live complex lives, right? So like you don't have, you know, you think about the last 29 days is like probably nobody in this room is like a scholar on the 29 days. You probably know everything you've like heard on TV. You know that like they're saying they're going to mobilize the National Guard and like Flynn. But like it takes a lot of energy to try and stay as focused on all these issues and do like the work you have to do, be a good partner or spouse, like be a parent. Like that's actually really hard. So how do we help people like make sense of it in a way that like doesn't overwhelm them? I think like has to be a real part of people's work. I think when I think about opening space for conversation, it really is like across the aisles. I think that the people who believe in equity and justice sort of are, they already get it, right? That they agree with each other mostly. I think that this question of like the Trump supporters or like who's talking to those people, I think is like a real question. And that's what I mean by opening up space for people in a way that you can be tough and sort of respect that people like have a different point of view, but not, I think one of the dangers here, and this is what happened with the free speech conversations, especially with the college debates, was this idea that like every idea just because it's put out has merit, right? So how do we say, like, you being racist is actually like a I hear you, right? It's still a bad, that's like not a good thing. And we can talk through it and work through it, but just because you think that, you know, Jews are bad people or like black people, you know, commit more crime than everybody else, like that's not a good idea, right? So I think that has to be a part of the work. And I'm also mindful that like at every level people struggle with this. When we met with Bernie, probably 2 years ago now, and He said one thing that will be important to say here is he said something about jobs, and we were like, we asked a question about jobs, and he said, I support a jobs bill that will bring 50 million jobs, right? And we said, well, how do you know those jobs will go to poor people or people of color? And he said, because there are more of them. And we were like, that's not how it works, Bernie, right? Like, you've been in the Senate as long as I've been alive, right? So if you think that literally just because there are more poor and black people that the jobs will definitely go to them, like, that is a crazy way to think about being a lawmaker. So how do we, like, help people at all levels, like, think about equity and justice and race in a more nuanced way? Because I'll never forget that from the conversation.
So how do you do that? Like, what did you say to him?
I think everybody was like, did he just say that? I think that was our,
Because I think that's what we're really interested in, right? You're from our world, right? You're thinking this is uneducated, misspoken, really off. But how do we get someone, so especially taking someone who, you know, we may largely presume is goodwill and wants to do the right thing. What do you say in that moment that makes it land in a way that, in this case, you know, Bernie Sanders can hear or that someone else could hear?
Yeah. So with him, we were talking about formulas, right? Yeah, we were okay. Like, here's how, at the here are other federal formulas that address equity and race and look at how successful or not successful they've been. And he was like, that makes sense to me. And then we worked with his team on those. Yeah. So like that was a way to do that. I do think a lot of people need to see, what's so interesting about the legacy of racism in this country is that people, to inflict the damage, people were really creative, but to undo it, people have lost all imagination, right? That they're like, oh, I can't, we can never do that. And you're like, redlining, like not giving black people like mortgages and stuff took a lot of energy to just be that racist, right? But you think about like undoing it, people are like, it can never, there's no money. And you're like, okay. So like, you know, I think some of this is about pushing people to imagine. I think about like reparations is something that people guffaw at. Yeah. And when I think about reparations, I think people get stuck on the word, but this idea, how do we focus on the idea, right? Yeah. The idea of acknowledge and repair, like that's what reparations is. And most people think about reparations as like a blank check. Like in the, if most people had to like offer a, sort of an example, it'd be like giving everybody money, giving every black person money. And when I think about reparations, I think about like systemic corrections for things that were intentionally done to do harm. So you think about like literacy, right? I'm a third generation reader, not because like my family didn't want to read, but because black people weren't taught to read. And my great-grandmother could sign her name, and she was incredibly proud of it, right? So I don't come from a legacy of reading. So when I think about a reparation for reading, it'd be like, what would it look like to give every low-income or poor black kid in a city a library every year until they are in 12th grade, right? That would be like a systemic correction for things. Or like every kid who was not on grade level got a tutor paid for by the government. Like that would be a way that you like correct for something that was intentionally done to do damage. It doesn't only have to be like sort of a blank check, but people have like lost their imagination when they think about how to fix the things that people did intentionally to do harm.
There's also something in what you're saying about kind of narrative and story, right? How is it that, I mean, it's going back to what you were saying earlier in terms of the right being able to tell a story. Well, this is not possible. This would cost too much. And then if you look at the facts on the ground, so earlier, Grand, I think, is not here anymore, but, you know, Grand Lum was here. And, you know, the Community Relations Service is this tiny, tiny part of the Department of Justice. The United States Institute for Peace is like a sliver of, like, barely accounted in the budget of the United States. Our defense budget is, you know, 40% of the budget, and it's like 0.00001.
Right.
And yet, the Republican Congress says we're going to get rid of the United States Institute of Peace because it doesn't do anything, right? So there's something about, I think it's not just lack of creativity, right? There's some intention, and then there's a storyboard of this is wasted federal money or this is unproductive. And so so one of the things that our field is also really interested in is the power of story. And how do we tell stories and narratives that are powerful, true, and can reorient and get people thinking differently? And that seems to be something that activists in particular, and your work in particular, you're incredibly good at. So I wonder if I could ask you, what can those of us in our field who, at least part of what we're about is eliciting and bringing narrative and story to the table, what can we learn from you and people whose work is more oriented around activism?
Yeah, think about stories as a way that ideas travel, which is what makes them so important, right? Mm-hmm. And when I think about what trauma does to people, whether trauma is Trump or racism or the police or poverty, that trauma does two things. I think it either actually takes your power away or makes you feel powerless when you have power. And part of our work as organizers is to either help people, either help systems restore power to people or help people themselves reclaim power. Mm-hmm. And I think the stories sort of function in that space. And like if we believe that the way that people think about the world informs the way they act in the world, that ideas become the mechanism for that and stories are the way that ideas travel. So I believe that. The second thing is about these issues of erasure, that as people of color, we often face erasure in one of two ways. One is that either the story is never told or is told by everybody but us. And in this moment, we became the unerased, right? Like we literally became the people able to tell our own stories and not have to just wait for dominant culture to reinforce or validate those stories. And I think that that is incredibly important too. I think that in some ways I think this moment is really interesting because there are more stories untethered to succinct ideas, right? So like in this moment, like you have seen a million stories about an immigrant not being able to come into the country or somebody who you know, is not a permanent citizen being kept out. So we have a lot of stories. I don't think we have like a tight message yet around like why that is like so clearly wrong and putting the right on defense about it. So stories are great, but when they're untethered to a succinct idea, I think they are less potent. So that'd be my offering.
Yes, that's helpful.
My offering there. And I do think the activist community probably does it better than most because so much is at stake. In this moment, too, with stories, it's like, how do we become really disciplined? Is that like part of their strategy that I think is working really well is that everything is screwed up, right? So you don't even know where to look. You're like, I thought I cared about education. DeVos can't even tweet correctly, right? You're like, that's a disaster. People are blocking her from going to schools. The EPA guy that just got confirmed, he sued the EPA 13 times. You're like, well, that seems pretty bad. You know, everybody seems like a disaster. So we're like okay with the SBA woman who is like the former wrestling woman. And we're like, she's the least dangerous of all the dangerous people, but probably like doesn't know much about small business, even if she's like a really nice person, right? What they have done is like shifted our idea of what normal and good is, and like we have to make sure that we like keep the bar where the bar is supposed to be. That the bar right now is this idea of like we're not Russia yet, you know? And it's like, well, that can't be what the bar is, right? Like the bar has to be like America means something and there are values and we defend those.
Right. So I'm gonna, Maddie, you said I can go a few minutes over, right? Okay, I'm gonna take, can I get some questions from people?
Yeah, of course, yeah.
So we have about 10 minutes, which is not a lot of time, but maybe I can get some questions from more, yes, sir, in the back. Yeah, if you press the, I think there's a button to press and then we'll hear
the button does something. Oh, there we go.
Yeah,
the button does something. So two kind of questions for you. One, first on sanctuary cities. To me, it seems like a failure in liberal messaging in that we've crafted the term sanctuary cities to be about the people that we're trying to protect instead of messaging to the people that might oppose our policy. Because being a sanctuary city isn't about protecting people at all costs, even if they're criminals. It's about telling the federal government that you can't tell our cops what they should be doing with their time and therefore our money. Like, you can't turn them into mini customs agents. So how do we communicate that in, you know, three words or fewer? So
I've spent very little time on this, but my gut says something like, we believe in small government too. Like, I think that'd be like an interesting, like, we believe that the power should be local. Like, some message that says like local, we also believe in local control, and like sanctuary cities are another mechanism of local control. Like, whatever would nail that idea. And I do think you're right. The sanctuary cities has become this idea that like, we will protect people at all costs. So like, the at all cost thing is what is getting people, as opposed to this idea that is a Republican idea of small government, local control. And this is just another way that we're exercising local control. I think could be like an interesting spin. I don't know the tight version of that yet. I'd have to think about that, but that'd be my gut.
So then the kind of follow-up then is, why don't Democrats embrace local control? I mean, I think it's over 80% of the United States GDP comes from metropolitan areas. The federal government, when it comes to spending, is essentially an insurance company with an army, if you look at where they spend their money. And in, you know, states like New Jersey get 67 cents back for every dollar they send to the federal government, whereas states like West Virginia get upwards of $3 or $4 back.
Yeah, because so, I think local control is not good in a lot of places for poor people and people of color, right? That like, I'm all about like local control, sort of, but I'm not about it when like you are teaching kids that slavery wasn't like a real thing and that the Civil War was about cotton only, right? Like, divorce from people. So I think that If I had to bet on something, I would bet on like really strong rules at a more central level that like the local people have to implement. Like, I think that is probably like better for most poor and brown and black people's lives, which is why I think that the left sort of talks about sort of these grand ideals and then tries to codify the grand ideals, because like in Mississippi and in Alabama, local control is like a dangerous thing for a lot of people, you know?
If I could just attack on, a few weeks ago I had the chance to talk with Barney Frank, and this question came up, and he said, because we care about people. Like, those people, their lives, like, will be appreciably worse without that federal funding and without the set of protections, especially vulnerable populations get from federal law on all sorts of issues. Although, I mean, clearly, maybe from a strategic perspective, there may be something there, but then there's these individual life perspective. Yeah. It's a tough question. Yeah.
It seems like then a lot of people in both rural and urban areas could become allies in such a scenario where both potentially have a problem around resources that they can solve together, as opposed to right now, it's fighting over resources, it seems. So.
Other questions? Yeah, David.
DeRay, what do you think about arts capacity to kind of be part of that dialogue, whether it's literature, music, different forms of art, especially where there's a lot of justice not being done, and perhaps it being not a substitute for, but maybe a complement for some kind of restorative justice?
So the question about the role of arts. So if we believe that the way people think changes the way that they act, and understand that the government often changes people's behaviors because it just sets up the system, but it doesn't necessarily change people's minds, that like neighbors change, this idea that real people change real people's minds, I think the arts have like a huge role to play as as the biggest carriers of stories, right? That art becomes a way that ideas travel. And I think that some of the most impactful work that we do very quietly is the work with influencers. So I think about when Colin decided not to stand up, right? Colin called in the middle of the night, and I never talked to Colin, and we had a really good call. And one of the things I said to him is like, Colin, like, he was like, DeRay, I'm gonna like donate to all these things, and da da da. And I'm like, you should do that, right? Like, that is important. The most important thing you have done, and the priceless thing you've done, is like, you forced the NFL, which is like a not racially progressive group of people to think about these issues, and like you've made it unavoidable. So like keep talking. So like I want you to like research those organizations. You should do that. But like make sure that your talking points every time you get in front of TV are tight, because like that is really important to us, right? So it's that work. I think that Beyonce's album and like the whole her speech at the Grammys, like that work was really thoughtful about being black and being about liberation. Solange, Kendrick, like those. I think that world is really strong, and I do think, and I know that people are working to organize in that space. I think the hard thing about our cultural influencers, especially the people with the biggest platforms, is that they don't often have space to mess up, you know? So they can't, if they say one thing wrong, it feels like the world's crashing down. So much of it has been like, how do we build their capacity quietly so they like get it right? So when they come out publicly, like they just have it, you know what I mean? So you talk to Solange, and Solange like super gets it, is ready to put everything on the line like for the message, and you're like, that is really dope, and there are a million people like her. It's also been real work to like connect all of them with each other. So like when Colin called, Colin was like, Derek, can you introduce me to like these? He had like four people. And I like knew three of them, but he wanted me to connect him to Kareem Abdul-Jabbar, and like I don't know Kareem Abdul-Jabbar. I know him. I like know who he is. So I like called a reporter who like knew his people, and then I call his like person, and I'm like, hey, this is DeRay. Colin wants to talk to Kareem, and like you know, and then I like connected them that way, and like that is like real work too, right? Like that has to be people. We all have to make sure that we do that to create like this network of people, so that like I'm not your only entrance to the work. Like you now have this relationship that I don't have. Like that is important so that you guys can be connected here. And I think that the question moving forward is like, how do we scale those types of things up? Like, what would it look like to train 100,000 people a month in this work? Like, what would it look like to get to imagine the Harlem Renaissance in the digital age, right? Like what would it look like to bring art together and to make it as focused as possible in that way, I think is interesting. Yeah, he had a question?
Yeah.
Yeah, I did. Okay.
Well, I think we'll make this our last, actually.
Yeah. Oh, I think she had one.
Oh, okay, we'll make two more.
Did you?
Okay. Good, we'll take yours and yours. Then we'll take it.
I guess, you're talking a lot about messaging, narratives, and I'm wondering sort of when you're talking about the president and how we don't want to normalize certain things, I guess there's a tension, that's a very common thing that people say, and there's a tension there with I think the fact that a lot of what he does is a culmination of things that have been sort of bubbling up for a long time. And then I think there's also like there's a an argument that's often made about like the way Silvio Berlusconi was finally defeated was people like treated him like a normal politician, and at the same time though you don't want to like normalize horrible things, right? I mean that seems like just normatively, but that seems like something that seems bad, right? And I guess I'm wondering how when you're messaging or talking about that stuff, how you deal with that tension.
Yeah, I think about, I think you're right. I think that it is true that Trump is the product, not the producer, right? Like, I think that's real. And I think the other day, at the press conference yesterday, which was a cluster of, it's funny because people were like, that press conference is going to be a reset. And you're like, no reset, just bad. that reporter said, but you're the president. Do you remember that moment? Like he was like, but somebody told me. And what is like, you're the president. And it was a perfect example of like treating him like a regular, how we would treat everybody else, right? That like you wouldn't let any other politician get off the hook for just like literally saying that they didn't know, like you're the highest person off. Like, so I think that to me is like what it means to not normalize like this wild behavior is to say like, you're the president. Like I expect something different from you. Or like when CNN of all places is not letting Kellyanne Conway come on, right? That like, we know you lied. The hard part is that like, if he was black, he would have been impeached by now, right? That like, this would have been over a long time ago. And it's again a question of like, how long do we let this fester before we decide that it's like an emergency? And the challenge is that a lot of people with a lot of power for whom Trump is just fodder, right? He's not impacting their life. It's fine. It doesn't, ACA could go away. They could pay for health insurance out of their pocket. And those are a lot of the people making some of these sort of bigger decisions about what is news and what isn't. So it's interesting and frustrating to see like what the lever is that finally makes people upset about it, right? Will it be the National Guard and cities working with ICE to round people up that finally will make people go crazy? And I was talking to somebody the other day who was a surrogate for Hillary's campaign who were like, they went out to all these communities and people were like, you're being really dramatic. Like, he would never do that. And now those people are freaked out. And you're like, we tried to tell you, you know. And not in like a I told you so way, but like you have to, you know, black people of color have always believed that the government can do bad things because we've seen the government do bad things. I think about myself as somebody who like, if you had told me I was going to get tear gas in the street, I would have been like, you are being so dramatic. I can't believe you say that. This is America. And then I got tear gas in the street and it was like, this is crazy, you know? So the last meeting with Obama, he's like, voting is really important. And I'm like, President Obama, I voted my entire life, got tear gas, maced, pepper sprayed, like smoke bombed, all those things. And it wasn't because I didn't vote, right? That we have to talk about how to build power in a more nuanced way. And voting is a part of that. But like, that was not enough for us, mm-hmm. right? And I think that has to be real too, that like we have to complicate those things.
Thank you.
So just for context, I'm South African, and so when I think about alternative dispute resolution, I do think a lot about the Truth and Reconciliation Commission. And I think that what I want to ask about is when activism is effective and we do get a seat at the table or there is a negotiation, how do we know that we're asking for enough? Because I think that, I mean, obviously hindsight is 50-50, but a lot of we look at South Africa now, and yes, at the time, a negotiated transition from apartheid to democracy is an amazing achievement, but also the socioeconomic status quo maintained itself, you know, all the structure maintained itself, and we're still in sort of like a very difficult, vulnerable position where people are suffering, for instance. So how do we know that, well, and I think this, people feel very similarly here about the civil rights struggle and what was decided and what was gained. How do we know that we're asking for enough when we're in the moment?
That is a great question. I think about, you know, I've been to many meetings, a lot of meetings, and I think about meeting with the White House for the first time. So it was Valerie, Jared, and like five of us, and Roy Austin from the Cops Department and the DOJ. And she was like, tell me what you want, right? And we had just finished Campaign Zero, so we were like, it was like a lot of things, right? And they were like, well, what are the most important? We're like, everything, right? It's like we're not gonna prioritize, like all of these things are equally important and we'll fight you about all of them, right? And like that was important for us. And I think there was something about being in the street and being so sort of viscerally upset that like we weren't willing to concede in the room because we were like, you didn't get tear gas, you didn't do any of this. And there was this one exchange with one of the people in the room who said something like, he said something that was minimizing tear gas, and Netta was like, did you get tear gas? And he was like, no, but that's not what I, and you're like, exactly, right? Like, you don't get to do that. I will say what the federal government, what the police has done that has been really effective for them and really hard for us is that they just don't collect data, right? So we know where, like, pizzas are at every Pizza Hut across the country being delivered. We know where, like, rainwater is being collected in, like, the marshes in the South, but we don't know how many people the police kill a year. And when you think about the Voting Rights Act, one of the ways that the Voting Rights Act actually got passed was that there was so much data. The federal government, there is almost no data around police violence. So any number you've ever heard about police violence is from a newspaper report. It's like any stat you've ever heard is from newspapers. So if you get killed in America and a newspaper doesn't write about it, you're like not in the data set, which is a wild thing. And the numbers that are gonna come from the federal government, because the Obama administration did make a commitment at the end to start collecting it, but it's heavily lagged. So we'll get the 16 data in 18. And you're like, well, that's not gonna change anything in people's lives. So it is interesting in this moment, like how do we collect the data in a way that like forces us to have a different kind of conversation? Because I've been in meetings and people will say like, well, you know, police union contracts are really crazy, or like use of force policies are really wild. And they're like, well, show us that if we fight for legislation on this, it'll have an impact. And it's like, there's very little data, and that's really hard. Or places like Baltimore, every single police report is on paper. So you're like, well, this isn't helpful, right? So how do we like fight, how do we like build the space up so that when we go into the room, we actually have all the tools we need to make the demands that we can defend? Because as somebody who's been in the room, it's easier to make the demands. And then when sympathetic people are like, well, like help me fill out the argument, and you're like, well, sorry, there's just no data. That like isn't enough, right? Like people aren't willing to stake their career on like, they really like me, you know?
Yeah.
Which makes sense.
That's great advice. That's awesome advice. Yeah. Thank you.
Awesome. Thank y'all.
Everybody, please join me in thanking DeRay.
We did it.